Brian O'Neill is the president of the Insurance Institute for Highway Safety.
And identical. Yeah. That's incredible.
One of the things we do, we put grease paint on the...
He runs a vehicle research center and is one of the foremost experts in the world on vehicle safety.
Where the dummy hits...
We use the term crashworthiness to describe the protection a car offers its occupants during a crash. Now, crashworthiness is a complicated concept because it involves many aspects of vehicle design. The structure, the restraint system, it all adds up to this single term we use, crashworthiness. We use the stripped-down body to illustrate the concepts of good and poor structural designs for modern crashworthiness.
Brian, why is it important for the vehicle's structure to perform well in a crash?
Well, this is what's left of the body and structure of a car that was in a crash, and we use this to illustrate the point. Basically, we want the occupant compartment or the safety cage to remain intact. We don't want any damage or intrusion into this part of the vehicle during the crash.
Okay.
We want all of the damage of the crash confined to the front end.
So even though all this metal looks the same, it's actually different. The green metal is intended to crumple, to give in the collision.
If we can crumple the front end of the car without allowing any damage to the occupant compartment, then the people inside can be protected against serious injury. Basically, we want the front end to be buckling during the crash so that the occupant compartment is slowed down at
right.
a gentler rate.
Right. Kind of like jumping off of a step and keeping your knees straight and landing on the floor versus bending your knees when you land.
Exactly the same concept. So this is a vehicle that did well because there's very little intrusion anywhere in the occupant compartment. These elements here, even though they're strong enough to hold an engine and suspension, actually buckled and crushed just like they're designed to do. So the damage is confined to the front end. We look at a vehicle like this, and this is an example of a very poor safety cage. This vehicle was in a 40-mile-an-hour crash, and as you can see that the occupant compartment has collapsed, it's been driven backwards. As a result, the driver's space has been greatly reduced, so someone sitting in this vehicle is obviously at a high risk of injury.
So even if the restraint systems do function properly, the airbag, the seat belts, the person is still in great danger.
This person in this vehicle, even with a belt system and airbag, is at significant risk of injury because the compartment is collapsing.
So it's analogous to shipping a box to China. You can have all the best packing in the world around the China, but if the box is weak, you're going to break the China.
When the safety cage collapses, you're going to have injuries to the occupants. So this is an example of poor crashworthiness. But this vehicle was in the same crash, 40 mile an hour, offset crash,
right.
And you can see that now the safety cage has remained intact.
Right.
There's very little intrusion anywhere. The damage is confined to the crumple zone of the vehicle. This is the way it should be. A person in a crash like this, wearing their seat belt and protected by the airbag, can walk away from the crash with no injury.
Right. If I stand over here, and I just look towards the rear of the car and I ignore the airbag, this doesn't even look like it's been in a crash.
That's right. This is good performance, good crashworthiness.
In our shipping box analogy, this is an example of a strong box.
That's right. The people in this box will be protected.
Since we first made this film, automakers have responded. And now, all vehicles perform well in the 40% overlap test. But the Institute and its current president, David Harkey, have continued to advance frontal crashworthiness testing.
So these are the vehicles that you and Brian were talking about.
Yeah.
Every vehicle passes this test with no problem now and gets a good rating. One of the things that we started looking at was why are we still having so many fatalities and frontal crashes,
right?
In good performing vehicles. And one of the things that we determined is that not all of those frontal crashes have a 40% overlap. There are many instances where the amount of overlap is much less than that. And so what we did was we created a test where the amount of overlap was 25%.
It's like the side of the car is being sheared away.
It really is, and so you can see from the two vehicles that we have here, this vehicle obviously got a poor rating. Everything was pushed back into the occupant compartment.
It's tough for the automakers to address, but looks like they did it here.
They strengthened the structure here. They also have to figure out how to design the suspension, the wheel, so that it doesn't push back into that firewall. And what makes this test so hard is that all of that energy is occurring outside of the primary structural frame rail.
Right, so they're missing the frame rail, which is the beginning of the crumple zone. So it's quite an engineering challenge to take all of that energy and still channel it in a way so that it doesn't intrude on the occupant compartment.
Yeah.
Is this 25% overlap test still evolving?
The biggest change with this test is we've added a very similar test for the other side of the vehicle. Now we've added a crash test dummy in the passenger seat to be able to look for injury metrics on that side of the vehicle as well.
Are you tweaking these front crash tests anymore?
There's nothing on the horizon in terms of the front seat right now, but we are looking at real world data and we're concerned about the rear seat. Uh-huh. And that's where we're going next.
All right.
It turns out, in some vehicles, passengers buckled up in the rear seat are more likely to be injured than those belted in the front seat. This was a surprise to me.
I'd always heard, you know, the back seat's always going to be a safer place to be, but it's not the case now.
Well, the important thing here is not that the rear seat has become less safe. It's just that our focus has been on the front seat for so long now. That's where the automakers have really looked to put interventions in the vehicle.
So what does the front seat have that the back seat doesn't?
The front seat has airbags that deploy to protect the passengers in the event of a frontal crash. It also has, in the belt system, two specific features nowadays: crash tensioners and force limiters. Both of these act in the event of a crash, the crash tensioner to pull the belt tight, and then the force limiter to let the webbing of the belt spool out just slightly to limit those forces on the chest during the crash.
So just like the crumple zone and the airbag, the physics is the same. You're increasing that time of impact, but just within the seatbelt mechanism.
All right.
In the rear seat, they don't have those things.
There are very few vehicles now in production that have those two components built into the belt system.
So your goal is to figure out what's the best test to show what's happening to the passenger in the rear seat. And once you've developed that test, then it's up to the automakers to try to figure out a way to make it safer.
That's correct.
And even though you're changing the test, the physics is still the same.
The physics is still the same. We're just moving to a different part of the vehicle.